For instance, one of the things we know about capital is that it must grow in order to survive. It must increase value. It must expand its range and its reach. Now, capital has to grow for one very simple reason, that capital has to work on the idea that there is profit at the end of the day. And if there is going to be profit, there has to be more at the end of the day. The classic way in which Marx described this was that the capitalist starts the day with a certain amount of money, goes into the market and buys labor power and means of production, puts the labor power and means of production to work to create a new commodity, then sells that commodity at the end of the day for the original amount of money plus the profit, i.e. what Marx called the surplus value, which means that there must be more at the end of the day than there was at the beginning of the day.
And the simple way to look at it is to say, look, a typical circulation process of accumulation goes like this. You start with some money, you go into the market and you buy labor power and means of production, and you put them to work with a given technology and organizational form. You create a commodity which you then sell for the original money plus a profit. Now, you then take part of the profit and you recapitalize it into an expansion.
So capitalism has to expand, it has to grow. And then the big question is, where does it grow? When Marx was writing, it mainly grew because the world was pretty empty. It could go to North America, build a new capitalism in North America. It could go to Argentina. It could go to Australia. It could conquer India and use that as its market. It could bring China in and make it the market. So when Marx wrote the Communist Manifesto in 1848, he described a situation in which he said, capital is destined to create the world market. It has to make the whole world its market eventually. But in 1848, there was plenty of room to expand. There continued to be plenty of room to expand in 1900. And there were difficulties after that with the two world wars, but during the 1950s and 1960s, capital could still continue to expand across the earth. In 1970, it faced a difficult problem. Where was it going to expand? But it had a piece of good luck. The Soviet Empire collapsed, so that was integrated into capitalism, and China was integrated into capitalism. But now we have the problem of China is already part of the capitalist dynamic, a very central part. Eastern Europe is in, and Russia is in. Where can we expand now? Well, there's some places in Africa and some other places, but by and large, the ability to expand is now facing a crisis.
Well, we've been since the 1970s in a phase of what we call wage repression, that wages have remained stagnant. The share of wages in national income right throughout the OECD countries has steadily fallen. It's even steadily fallen in China, of all places. So that there are less and less being paid out in wages. Well, wages turn out to be also the money which buys goods. So if you diminish wages, then you've got a problem with where's your demand going to come from? And the answer was, well, get out your credit cards. We'll give everybody credit cards. So we'll overcome, if you like, the problem of effective demand by actually pumping up the credit economy. And American households, British households, have all roughly tripled their debt over the last 20, 30 years.
Hello, I'm Kamal Santa Maria. This is Counting the Cost on Al Jazeera, your weekly look at the world of business and economics. This week, debt, and lots of it. In fact, more than there was when the financial crisis hit. And while Western nations still try to get a grip 7 years later, it's emerging nations and corporations that could trigger the next banking crisis.
As prices rise and incomes are squeezed, it's becoming increasingly difficult for most people to make ends meet, according to a major new report. It found that over half of adults in the UK are struggling to pay their bills. That compares to 7 years ago, before the banking crash, when 35% said they found it hard to keep up payments.
We've just been paid today, and that's all gone out on bills. So we've got about £10 to live on for until next week now. I've got two kids, so it's quite hard.
Many more people across the UK are simply running out of money and finding it hard to make ends meet. Back in 2006, before the financial crisis, 35% of adults said that they were struggling to keep up with their bills and their credit commitments. Now it's 52% who, when asked the same question, say they're struggling. In some parts of the UK, it's even worse than that. The English region where it's highest is the North West at 60%, but Northern Ireland is even higher than that, with 66% saying they're struggling. And even in the West Midlands, which has the lowest figure, 44% are still under severe financial pressure. London, Wales, Scotland are all about average.
There's a chart I saw recently that I can't get out of my head. A Harvard business professor and economist asked more than 5,000 Americans how they thought wealth was distributed in the United States. This is what they said they thought it was. Dividing the country into five rough groups of the top, bottom, and middle three 20% groups, they asked people how they thought the wealth in this country was divided. Then he asked them what they thought was the ideal distribution, and 92%, that's at least 9 out of 10 of them, said it should be more like this. In other words, more equitable than they think it is. Now that fact is telling, admittedly, the notion that most Americans know that the system is already skewed unfairly. But what's most interesting to me is the reality compared to our perception. The ideal is as far removed from our perception of reality as the actual distribution is from what we think exists in this country. So ignore the ideal for a moment. Here's what we think it is again. And here is the actual distribution. Shockingly skewed. Not only do the bottom 20% and the next 20%, the bottom 40% of Americans barely have any of the wealth. I mean, it's hard to even see them on the chart. But the top 1% has more of the country's wealth than 9 out of 10 Americans believe the entire top 20% should have.
Inequality. We know it's a problem in the U.S., but is it really a problem here in Canada? A recent study asked Canadians what they think the ideal distribution of wealth should be and how it is actually divided. The results from that study are shocking. If we break the total population of Canada down into a representative group of 100 people, the richest on the right, the poorest on the left, here's what it looks like when we distribute the total wealth of all Canadians. That's roughly $8 trillion in 2012, distributed according to how Canadians think wealth should be divided. This looks pretty good. There's a very healthy middle class, with the middle 60% of Canadians owning roughly 60% of the wealth. The richest group here are certainly well off, but they are only about 3 times richer than the poorest Canadians, who still own a significant share of the pie. Now, here's how Canadians think wealth is actually distributed in Canada. In short, a lot more unequal. Canadians think the richest 20% own 10 times the wealth of the poorest. But even here, things are still pretty good. Yes, Canadians believe that the wealthiest 20% own more than half the country's wealth, and think the bottom 20% own only a little more than 5%. But this is still somewhat equal. There's still a sizable middle class, and poorer Canadians have at least some share of the pie. Ideally, Canadians want a more balanced distribution than what they think exists. Even most conservatives chose this fairer distribution. This shows that Canadians understand that wealth is divided unfairly, and that the current system is skewed. But there's something even more disturbing going on. As bad as Canadians think inequality is, the reality is much worse. Let me explain. The most alarming thing about these results is that Canadians vastly underestimate the actual level of wealth inequality in Canada. In 2012, nearly 70% of all wealth belonged to the top 20% of Canadians. The wealth share of the poorest 20%? As you can see, it barely registers on this chart. The reality is that the bottom 20% of Canadians own almost nothing, less than 1% of the country's wealth. And the bottom 10%, they actually have more debt than assets. It's hard to believe. The bottom half of all Canadians, half of the people who, like you, will watch this video, together, own less than 6% of the wealth, a far cry from the healthy middle class we keep hearing about. The picture is even worse if you look at financial assets like stocks and bonds. The top 10% hold 60% of financial assets. That's more than the bottom 90% combined. Canada's CEOs make more than 200 times that of their average worker, one of the worst gaps of any advanced country. Perhaps that's why the top 1% likely owns nearly 20% of all wealth. A wealth pile so massive, it does not even fit on this chart. Canada is now a place where the richest 86 families own more than the bottom 11 million people combined. Canada wasn't always this unequal. We got here because of the political choices we've made. Our social spending has been reduced dramatically since the 1980s.
Earnings have not kept up in line with inflation. That makes us all feel worse off. Over the next few years, those on benefits are also going to feel a particular additional squeeze as cuts are introduced.
Now, how did that happen? Well, we've been since the 1970s in a phase of what we call wage repression. That wages have been remained stagnant. The share of wages in national income right throughout the OECD countries has steadily fallen. It's even steadily fallen in China, of all places. So that there are less and less being paid out in wages. Well, wages turn out to be also the money which buys goods. So if you diminish wages, then you've got a problem with where's your demand going to come from? And the answer was, well, get out your credit cards. We'll give everybody credit cards. So we'll overcome, if you like, the problem of effective demand by actually pumping up the credit economy. And American households, British households, have all roughly tripled their debt over the last 20, 30 years. And a vast amount of that debt, of course, has been within the housing market. And out of this comes a theory which is very, very important, that capitalism never solves its crisis problems. It moves them around geographically. And what we're seeing right now is a geographical movement of that. Everybody says, well, okay, everything's beginning to recover in the United States, and then Greece goes bang, and everybody says, what about the pigs, you know? And it's interesting. You had a finance crisis which in the financial system. You've sort of half solved that, but at the expense of a sovereign debt crisis.
Now, it's important to understand the character of compound growth. The classic story which we tell on this is that the person who invented the game of chess was offered a reward. And the king, or whoever it was, offered the reward, said, tell me what reward you want. And the person who invented it said, put one grain of rice on the first square of the chessboard, put two grains on the second, and then double it across all of the squares. So you get a sequence, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, and what you see here is a gradual curve that gets faster and faster moving upwards until, after a while, it goes like this. And in that chess reward scheme, by the time you got to the 32nd square, you had used up all the rice in the world, which then posed you a problem of how do you get from the 32nd square to the 64th square when there's no rice left. The only way you can do it is, in fact, by pledging next year's rice harvest, but then you have to pledge the year after 2 years' rice harvest, then 4 years' rice harvest, and by the time you get to the 64th square, you've actually got close to pledging the rice harvest into infinity.
Hello everyone, we're taking one of our big picture looks this week on Counting the Cost, and an important picture it is too. Debt, the trigger for the financial crisis. Households mortgaged up to the eyeballs, unable to repay their debts. And let's not forget the banks and the institutions which made it all possible. What followed from the collapse of Lehman Brothers to the Greek debt crisis, It all suggested the world would no longer fall foul of debt. You would think our addiction to debt would encourage some sort of, I don't know, detox. No chance. Rather than falling, debt has actually increased by $57 trillion to $199 trillion, according to the McKinsey Global Institute. That number is a staggering 287% of global GDP. But would you believe there's a bigger issue? And it's actually in the emerging economies, where companies have increased their dollar-denominated debt to $18 trillion by last year. And look at it, in 2004, it was only $4 trillion. That's what the IMF says. And so with companies setting aside more money to pay the interest on their loans, that means less money going into the economy. And now take a look at these nations here. We've got Brazil, China, India, South Africa, Turkey. Those numbers there from 2007 is a total debt as a percentage of GDP. It's very much manageable at that point. But here it is by the end of 2014, and all of those countries, as you can see, have been sucked into fueling their economies with credit.
The gap between the very richest and the rest of us is getting bigger. Why? A common belief is that it's good for us all if a small group of people earn an enormous amount of money. The theory is that their wealth trickles down to the rest of us. But this is a myth. In reality, money is sucked up from all of us into the pockets of a very small group of people. How does this happen? One reason is the way that money is created. Right now, almost all of the money in our economy is created by banks when they make loans. Now, most people assume that when banks make loans, they're lending out someone else's savings. But they're not. Instead, when somebody takes out a loan, banks create new money electronically by typing numbers into their account. 97% of all the money in our economy is created in this way, as people take out loans from banks. The more loans people take, the more debt there is, and the more money there is. The shocking fact is, if nobody went into debt, there would be almost no money in the economy.
Other thing everybody knows, but no one really wants to talk about. Money is debt. Banknotes are just a bunch of circulating IOUs. Don't believe me? Look at any banknote in your pocket. It says, "I promise to pay the bearer the sum of £5. See? It's an IOU. Pounds are either circulating government debt, or they're created by banks by making loans. That's where money actually comes from.
Our economy depends on the electronic money created by banks. But because the money is created when people borrow, someone, somewhere, has to pay interest on every pound created. In effect, we are renting the money we need to run our economy from the banks. This means that in the UK alone, together we pay the banks £192 million in interest every single day. And because the debt is held mostly by the bottom 90% and wealth mostly by the top 10%, paying this interest transfers money from the bottom 90% of the population to the very top 10%. It sucks wealth and income from the rest of us up to the very lucky few. So as long as we have to rent the money we use from the banks that create it, we'll have to keep paying this huge interest bill, and the gap between the richest and the rest of us will keep increasing.
So part of the strategy that the capitalists took in trying to discipline labour was to liberate finance capital so it could go to wherever the wages were lowest. As a result of that, finance capital deindustrialized much of the United States and much of Europe and most of the traditional centers of working class organization. Financialization didn't occur by accident. It was a strategy to disempower labor. But in disempowering labor, it also disempowered national governments, who lost more and more control over capital flow. All of the data from most of the countries that are central to the capitalist enterprises show that the share of labor in national income has been declining steadily since the 1970s. All of the data show that since the 1970s, the rich have become much richer and the poor have become relatively poorer. What happens with the market when workers have less purchasing power. Well, one of the things you can do is to give the workers credit. And then they can use their credit cards to deal with the fact that there's a lot of consumer goods out there that will not be consumed unless they have access to them. Now, this creates a very interesting situation. And I think it puts us in a sense to try to understand where we are right now. It's against that background that we see that capital is spending much, much more of its assets and its resources on urban development. For instance, what happened in the United States after about the year 2000 is that more and more money went into the housing market, and more people were drawn into the housing market as a way of supplementing their income.
During the past decade, Toronto's skyline has altered dramatically, with the highest rate of condominium construction in North America.
The problem is it's spiraled out of control, and it's spiraled out of control because City Hall has never had the power to say no.
Is the individual condo owner now a mere byproduct of a fast-moving international money market?
There's all this hot money swirling around the world, trying to find a place to land.
With some developers putting profit before quality, it's become a case of buyer beware.
Developers essentially are running the downtown core in Toronto. They build what they want to build.
This is my view right here. This is sweet, eh?
Well, I'm paying about $1,700 a month to live here, and this is basically like camping.
It's a high-speed collision of corporate and consumer interests.
Everybody makes money all the way up the line. Poor Johnny consumer, in the end, gets what he's given.
Could Toronto and its citizens be caught in a game that's rigged against them?
Capitalist growth from the 1990s onwards was increasingly dependent upon a very rapid process of urbanization. That is, more and more capital was flowing into urban forms of development. And this is very different from what existed in the 19th century, when capital would move from, say, Britain to the United States to build a new economy. This was capital moving around the world, moving into cities and rebuilding cities on a global basis. In other words, planetary urbanization became one of capital's central strategies of development. And we're now locked into that as a major strategy, and it's very difficult to see how capital can get out of it. For instance, I've argued that the United States' growth during the period after 2000 to 2008 was entirely driven by consumerism, which was connected to the speculative activities in the housing market.
Consumers believe the condo game is about home ownership, when really, it's as much about money markets.
Some of these downtown condos are just vehicles for flipping and for money laundering and for tax evasion and for people to hide their assets away from what, for whatever reason.
The supply and demand is only that of money, not real estate. And that, I think, is the fundamental thing that everybody gets wrong.
In the land of snakes, there's always a king cobra.
King Cobra was realtor Charles Haynes' nickname when he was a top developer's sales agent in Toronto. Haynes has been in the condo game since 1979 and now represents buyers, almost entirely international investors.
Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Saudi Arabia. Russia's actually one of my key markets. We sold 86 units last year to people who've never come to the country, never looked at the condo, never seen the country. I've got repeat clients who bought 6, 7, 8 condos through me, never having come to Canada.
Today, Haynes is on the hunt for empty buildings where suites might be going for bargain prices.
And if you see all of the white curtains on all of the windows, either you have the most consistent design concept within a building, or you have a whole bunch of unsold suites. So a guy like myself, I tour around town and I count the number of blocked windows I see in a completed high-rise. That's a developer with inventory that he wants to sell, and that's where the King Cobra steps back in. Hey, Fazul, how's things in Dubai? Cool. It's time for me to go and meet with the developer now and see if we can make some kind of a bulk buy. Absolutely, it makes it more or less affordable for Joe Average. The industry's not really set up for Joe Average. It wasn't set up to be a housing alternative play as much as it is a commodities play for investors.
When that all crashed in 2008, this actually posed some very, very serious problems. Problems in the financial system, but also problems in consumption, because there was no longer the consumption there, and the argument Marx makes in Volume 2 became very prophetic at this point, because without sufficient consumption, then all of those producers who were connected to the American consumer market had a very difficult time. In fact, the collapse of consumption inside of the United States created a huge problem for the export industries of China. And there were estimates that at the beginning of 2009, China had lost 30 million jobs in the export sector. But a survey at the end of the year of net job losses in China suggested that China had lost only 3 million jobs, which means that somehow or other in 2009, they actually created 27 million jobs. How did they do that? They did the same as Haussmann had done in Paris back in the 1850s, and as Robert Moses did in the United States in 1945. They went into a frantic phase of city building. They built whole new cities in inner China which had nobody living in them. They built infrastructures, and of course they liberated the purchase of housing through financial aid to people who wanted to buy. In other words, they constructed a speculative boom in the housing market. The housing prices in Shanghai were doubling every 2 years, and while that has slowed down, it is still a very rapid rate of expansion. China was the only country to really manage very, very strong growth in the immediate wake of the crash of 2008. But that growth actually spilled over to all of those countries that were, all those economies that were providing raw materials to the China urbanization project. That is, Chile did very well because it was sending the copper. Australia did very well, it was providing raw materials. Much of Latin America became heavily involved in the China trade, providing soybeans to China. So the urbanization project in China was a huge boost to the global economy. China has consumed half of the world's cement output since 2008, half of the world's steel supplies, a large proportion of the world's copper resources. So there is, in effect, a continuation of the property boom in China that crashed in the United States. So we're seeing a repeat of what happened in the United States, but this time in China. And the big question is, what happens when the China boom crashes? But capital is not only engaged in city building in China, it's also rebuilding and remaking the cities of the Western world. All of the major cities that I've visited have property booms in place. All of those property booms are about building a certain kind of city, the kind of city that capital wants. Capital has no interest in building cities for people. It only has an interest in building cities for profit. So what are the profitable activities that the capitalists can engage in? Capitalists love mega projects. They hate to be bothered with neighborhood activities. So they like the mega projects of building new stadiums, building new parts of the city. They love projects which have a high rate of return, which means building the kind of city that the rich people want to live in. So capital actually builds high-value housing for a limited market. In fact, a lot of what capital builds is not actually lived in.
That's what happened in Vancouver, where housing prices are out of sight, yet many of the units in the big condo development at Cole Harbour sit empty. They're second or third homes for wealthy jet-setters.
Well, Cole Harbour is one of the most gorgeous settings on the planet, but there's no soul there. And it's jokingly called see-throughs, see-through city, because there's nobody in those apartments.
It's a very interesting thing in New York City to go around and look at all of the buildings at night and see how many of these new buildings have the lights on. And the answer is a lot of them are empty because people bought the apartments as a speculation, not as a place to live. And when you say, who are these people? Well, it's Russian oligarchs or it's Saudi princes or it's people with vast amounts of money from Latin America who want a place in Miami or New York. The same is true in London. London is essentially priced out of the market in terms of available housing for the mass of the population. There's a tremendous shortage of affordable and decent housing for the mass of the people, and an overproduction of speculative properties for the ultra-rich. And the result is that the cities are being used again and again and again in the purpose of this endless capital accumulation. Because there's tremendous pressure on capital to find places to put its money and find places to construct profitable investment opportunities in the face of this sudden shift in the compound rate of growth. Now, when I look at this story and I've connected it back and said, you could see the same processes that you are now experiencing here in Fortaleza, in Paris in 1850, in London in 1870, in the United States in 1945. You can see it in almost every city of the world right now, in which capital has to make and remake cities in its own image because it has nothing else better to do.
How do you fix this? Abandoned homes, foreclosures weighing down neighborhoods. It's America's continuing foreclosure crisis, and it's playing out in cities just like this one, Orange, New Jersey. Architects here at the Museum of Modern Art think they might have the solution, and believe it or not, it involves building in the streets.
This is an experiment to look at what happens if you get rid of streets and we create a pedestrian city.
The plan by architects Hilary Sample and Michael Meredith is on display in an exhibit called Foreclosed, Rehousing the American Dream.
We're not necessarily saying it's going to fix everything, but the idea that it provokes a kind of new discussion and conversation.
Their idea, fill the streets with housing and office space, make it pedestrian friendly, and eliminate the tax burden of upkeep on the roads. Looking at life after the foreclosure crisis, the exhibit reimagines how we live. Curators Barry Bergdahl and Reinhold Martin challenged architects to reimagine five suburbs across the country.
All of them lie within metropolitan areas that are growing. There's opportunities in these decaying suburbs.
It's creative, but how is it a solution to foreclosures?
The show, I should say, in general, is not trying to solve the mortgage crisis. That's for the banks to sort out.
But it creates an insane form of urbanization, in which the mass of the people have nowhere to live, just simply so that capital can reproduce.
The undesirable people have been cleared out of urban spaces.
And cities in the last 20 or 30 years, particularly in North America, have become much more sanitized, much more controlled by questions of zero tolerance, by questions of really aggressive policing to clear out those that are deemed to be sort of not fitting a model of urban life which is centers on consumption, which centers on business. So there's been a really powerful shift in cities to sort of criminalize homelessness, to criminalize panhandlers, to criminalize those not seen to belong in this what Neil Smith in New York has called the revanchist city, the city taking back space spaces for the wealthy, effectively.
Professor David Harvey.
Again, this has been going on a long time. You expel populations. You do it in a variety of ways. I mean, one of the ways, of course, is just simply raising rents so that costs become so high that people cannot live here. So there's an out-migration of low-income populations from New York City, for example, because they can't afford to live here anymore. So they go out into small towns in Pennsylvania up or in New York State. They're just forced out by cost of living concerns. I mean, that's one of the big ways. And then, of course, there's planned gentrification, and then there's redevelopment. So, you know, NYU will redevelop some area and use eminent domain for private purposes. And again, eminent domain was meant for public purposes, but public, you know, eminent domain is being used to expel populations. Columbia University is doing the same sort of thing. So you gentrify the whole city so that Manhattan has now become, if you like, one vast gated community for the rich. And hardly surprisingly, you know, most low-income populations cannot afford to live here. So they're living way, way out in the suburbs. And I came into Kennedy Airport the other day at 6 o'clock in the morning. I got on the E-train, and the E-train from Jamaica was absolutely packed. And it was packed with mainly women of color, obviously exhausted, coming in at 6:30 in the morning to try to wake the city up so the suits could come in at 9 and their coffee was ready and everything was good. Now, those are the people who are trying to live on $30,000 a year, and they have to live way, way out in Jamaica. They cannot live close to their place of work at all. And of course, the transport cost is also a significant burden on their lives. And so this is the kind of city which you've been creating in New York. And when I talk about the right to the city, I think about the rights of those people on the E-train at 6:30 in the morning to create a different kind of city where they could live close to work, where they could actually do the things they need to do to have a decent life.
Now, what this leads to, I think, is the following conclusion, that we can continue to fight all of the struggles we have to fight to try to preserve neighborhoods, to try to prevent evictions and dislocations. We can do it in a better way than we do now by combining together many different struggles of homeless people, anti-gentrification movements, affordable housing movements, and the like. But what Marx teaches is at some point or other, we have to go to the root of the problem. And the root of the problem is capitalism. We have to find some way to transform many of the movements we are working with into an anti-capitalist movement. And we have to ask some questions as to what that anti-capitalist movement would try to do. One of the issues that Marx raises in Volume 1, Page 1 of Capital is the distinction between use values and exchange values. What conventional economics teaches is that the best way and the most efficient way to get use values to people is to liberate the market process so that the exchange value system can freely function. I'm old enough to remember in the 1950s being promised that global poverty would be eliminated by liberating the market. I heard the same story in the 1960s and in the 1970s. And it took me until about the 1980s, when I'm nearly 60 years old, to realize this was a total lie. That actually the market system produces poverty. The market system produces inequality. The market system deprives many people of access to needed use values. What kind of society would you prefer to live in? One which delivered the use value of decent housing, free education, free health care to everybody in the population on an egalitarian basis. Would you rather live in that kind of society or one which rations access to health care, education, housing, and the like through the market system? What Marx suggested is that we should limit our reliance upon the market system and capital accumulation and emphasize the provision of use values. Now, over the last 20 years or so, what we've seen are more and more social movements emerging in cities. Sometimes these movements come with violent and disruptive protests. And what this means is that there's a great reserve of discontent with the qualities of urban life. So one of the things we see is the emergence of even greater inequality since 2008 than existed before 2008.
The racking up of wealth. You would have thought the crisis would have stopped that. Actually, more billionaires emerged in India last year than ever. They doubled last year. The wealth of the rich, I mean, just read something this morning, in this country has accelerated. Just 2 years, just last year, what happened was the main leading hedge fund owners got personal remunerations of $3 billion each in 1 year. Now, I thought it was obscene and insane a few years ago when they got $250 million. But they're now hauling in $3 billion.
In other words, after 2008, capital and the top 1% have done very well. And the people have done very badly. And the only way in which that could be changed is by having a mass movement amongst the people. And one of the demands of that mass movement of the people has to be to pay careful attention to the qualities of urban life for everybody in the population, to make real this constitutional engagement that says people have a right to be consulted. Because a lot of these movements that have occurred in the last 15, 20 years have been about lack of democracy, a democracy that is given over to the quest for greater levels of social justice. Capital cannot concede that. Because capital is locked in to this business of only making cities of the sort that it wants. And if capital cannot address the real needs of the people, then capital should go. And we have to find alternative ways of structuring economic life, some of which already exist around us and can be found in the organizational forms that exist in the cities. This is a very critical historical moment when urbanization and what's going on in the cities becomes a key political question. Unfortunately, we are not the only ones to realize and recognize that. Because what capital class power is doing right now is trying to create a form of the state apparatus which is effectively going to militarize urban life. And what we're seeing is actually the emergence of repressive apparatuses in cities which are actually criminalizing protest, criminalizing those people who are searching for an alternative basis for urban life. This is where a lot of the struggle lies right now. And I think that there are signs that this struggle is growing and becoming more and more significant. And it's also becoming global. And it's also becoming more explicitly anti-capital. I think what's going on right now is essentially insane. And I think that the only sane way out is to try to become more and more concerned to construct an anti-capitalist movement. Part of that movement will be around demanding the right to the city and the right to social justice in the city. Part of that will be about maximizing the delivery of use values and minimizing the exchange value power. And part of it will also be about the search for democratic forms of representation and decision making. In other words, it's going to involve the construction of some sort of alternative political program which moves us steadily away from the capitalist track onto something radically different.